Well, in 1951, Merce Cunningham wrote an article. At that time, he constantly had to explain himself what he was doing, because most of the other people in the dance world thought he was out of his mind, I believe.
Do you think they still think that?
No. Now he's an icon. They still don't understand it, but they don't think he's out of his mind. You know, they know he's a genius now. And like Einstein, they don't understand what it is. They just accept it. And they might not like it. But when he was writing about the body, he was creating his own technique. And you know, since he, 1951, he had been out of the Graham Company for, 6 years, I guess. Something like that. So he hadn't formed a company yet. He was training dancers. Still, he was probably teaching at Black Mountain that summer, I believe. And he was probably working in a little studio in New York trying to train dancers. He was trying to figure out what he was doing. He was creating his own technique. But his basic principles, what he says here in this article that he wrote, and if you read any of the things he wrote, it's extremely articulate and well organized and well thought out. But some of the things he says are, he inherited these principles from the people he worked with, because having worked, I didn't work with Martha Graham, but I worked with her followers, and the idea of the discipline of the body, the daily work as a spiritual activity, is consistent with other choreographers, other great choreographers who preceded him, whether it was Martha Graham or I'm not sure what Jose thought about it, but probably Doris Humphrey. All the people that worked with Dennis Shawn, I think they felt the same way, because I heard Ted Shawn talk the same way. And in fact, all the classical people, classical teachers at the same time, felt the same way about the daily work of the body as a spiritual exercise of renewal, not just learning how to do things to perform tricks. And what he says here, I mean, this is abridged. Technique is the disciplining of one's energies through physical action in order to free that energy at any desired instant in its highest possible physical and spiritual form. For the disciplined energy of a dancer is the life energy magnified and focused for whatever brief fraction of time it lasts. The most essential thing in dance discipline is devotion, the steadfast and willing devotion to the labor that makes the classwork not a gymnastic hour and a half, or at the lowest level, a daily drudgery, but a devotion that allows the classroom discipline to be moments of dancing too. And not in any sense the feeling that each class gives an eager opportunity for willful or rhapsodic self-expression, but that each class allows in itself and further the dancer towards the synthesis of the physical and spiritual energies. The final and wished for transparency of the body as an instrument and as a channel to the source of energy becomes possible under the discipline the dancer sets for himself, the rigid limitations he works within in order to arrive at freedom. An art process is not essentially a natural process. It is an invented one. It can take actions of organization from the way nature functions, but essentially man invents the process. And from or for that process, he derives a discipline to make and keep the process functioning. The discipline, too, is not a natural process. The daily discipline, the continued keeping of the elasticity of the muscles, the continued control of the mind over the body's actions, the constant hoped-for flow of the spirit into physical movement, both new and renews, is not a natural way. It is unnatural in its demands on all the sources of the energy. But the final synthesis can be a natural result, natural in the sense that the mind, body, and spirit function as one. The technical aim is not to do a few or many things spectacularly, but to do whatever is done well, whether a smaller or greater amount of actual physical skill is required, and approaching as a goal the flawless. To walk magnificently and thereby evoke the spirit of a god seems surpassingly more marvelous than to leap and squirm in the air in some incredible fashion and leave only the image of oneself. For that very reason, the dancer strives for complete and tempered body skill, for complete identification with the movement in as devastatingly impersonal a fashion as possible. Not to show off, but to show. Not to exhibit, but to transmit the tenderness of the human spirit through the disciplined action of a human body. And that's just several paragraphs of quite a long, detailed article in which he continues to describe the center of the body being the spine and how all movements emanate from the spine. And that's what connects us with the old moderns, basically, is the use of the spine. But he did write that the year after I was born, okay, 1951. So that was quite a while ago.
And when did you join the Cunningham Company?
And I joined the Cunningham Company in 1980, August 1980. I replaced Robert Kovich, who was one of Merce's, I'd say, lead dancers, along with Chris Comar. He left the company after a season, I think the first Sadler's Wells season that the company did in 1980. I believe that was maybe it was not the first, but it was after the Sadler's Wells season.
Something people might not understand about the way the Cunningham Company works is that when a new dancer comes in, he doesn't come in and do background or core work, but simply takes over the significant roles of the person he replaces.
Generally, because it's more practical that way, to replace the person who's left. For this particular moment, I was in the Jose Limon Company, and I had several friends in the Cunningham Company. When they arrived back from their tour, they told me that Robert Kovich had left the company, so I came to the studio to study. And after several weeks, Merce came by because he had just, I think, gotten double arthroscopic surgery on his knees. He had done his last sound dance, actually, there in Sadler's Wells, and he never did it again. And so I came to the studio, and of course, Chris Comar was my friend. We were students at Jacob's Pillow the summer before he came to New York and became a Cunningham apprentice. That was in 1971. So he came, so I had a friend in Chris, and there was a workshop. We had quite a few boys here. There were 12, including me. And everybody knew there was a position available. And we had a workshop, 12 boys, and I guess there were 16 girls. It was quite a workshop, fielding sixes. And at the end of the workshop, I was on tour with the Jose Limon Company in Arles, in France, and we finished our performance, and I hopped on a train to Marseille, and then broke my ticket that I had with Limon to return, and I paid for my ticket to come back to New York to take the workshop. A few people knew I was doing it. And actually, it's kind of a strange story because after the first week of the workshop, I was a little nervous because I had to go back the following week to work with the Lamon Company. So I asked Merce if he could decide whether he was going to take me into the company. And that was quite pushy as I look at it now, because people don't usually do that. And all he really said was, well, let's try it. And so I stole the job from a number of people who had been here quite a while.
What do you think Merce saw in you then?
I don't know if what he really saw in me. I mean, I was very, I was gung-ho for sure. I was almost, you know, 28, 29 years younger. So I was very gung-ho. And well, I had a friend in Chris. I wouldn't be surprised if Chris put in a good word for me. And the period of time before that, I had some private classes with different company members. I would take extra classes in order to figure out the technique, because of course I had never had the Cunningham technique. I had been trained in Graham, Lamon, and ballet.
What made you want to leave Lamon and join Cunningham?
Well, it was much more exciting here. First of all, to work with a living choreographer and a taskmaster, a teacher like Merce, who was extremely demanding, and there was much more synthesis between the study of his technique and his work. Although I didn't really know his work, except I had seen it. I didn't know it to do it. I didn't know how complicated it really was, except that when I watched it, I saw it the first time in 1972, his company. So I didn't really understand it at the first season I saw it, but the more I did see it, the more I was intrigued by it, and the more fascinated I was, because there was so much to look at. And there was so much that I could go again and again to the performances and see different things.
In the same dance?
In the same dance. And I thought that was, wonderful. Because, of course, I had been in dancing with companies that were directly expressive, and they sought to convey a specific meaning and a specific mood or story. And that had been my basic training with Graham and Lamon. So I was ready to move on. I mean, at that time I had been doing the Morse Pavan, where I had a specific character. You know, usually you played a character in these dances. They were dramatic dances, and you had a characterization, and you responded to the music cues. And to be perfectly honest, stale is a good word. I felt it all. I felt stale after a while, even though it was a brief time. I mean, it wasn't that long. I was only in that company for 2 years, but I felt it was. I felt there was something else. And coming here to the Cunningham studio, it was more consistent with the work that I had done with Kazuko Hirabayashi, where she was the teacher. We studied technique with her, and then she made choreography on us. So that relationship between the teacher and as teacher and choreographer, master teacher and choreographer, that synthesis was enlivening. Merce's technique is organized. First we start, you know, standing still in a parallel position, so that you're basically working with out of the legs. The spine is moving out of the legs and out of the pelvis, and stretching the spine one way or the other, from the pelvis, from the back, from the leg. It's that integration between the back and the leg that makes a modern dancer. That's how I would usually define it, because classical dancers basically move from the pelvis down, and they move their legs. Their spine goes in accordance to the leg movements.
When you think of the body in Cunningham technique, do you divide it the waist or the hip, upper and lower?
Well, I think of the spine, and now the waist is, moves above the pelvis. The pelvis is actually the engine. The engine of the body is in the pelvis. And that's where all movement actually comes from. Now, the strength of the spine is created in how the pelvis is used against the legs, basically. He does give the same exercises in the warm-up. Are they fixed? Well, I guess you could call it fixed, but since he gives them at such different tempos all the time, it's new. It's a challenge each time, so it's not always a pleasant challenge, but it's always a challenge.